All right, so this is the tutorial on lists, and here's some of the things that I'm going to cover. First, I'm going to show you how to search an unordered list, and then we're going to show you how to sort a list, and there's lots of different ways you can do a sort. And once that list is sorted, we'll show you how to search it, which is a lot faster than doing an unordered list. And with that searched list, we can also do a binary search. So here's what the situation is. You just had a meeting with your manager, and she has a million names and some notes. And here's what your notes look like. She has a million names in a database, or a million plus names, and they want the higher ups management wants to be able to have a program that users can look up by zip code. They want it to move very fast. So that's one of the main prerequisites. You have to use existing Java libraries. You can't go writing a brand new library, even though you want to. And you need a simple demonstration for the vice presidents by tomorrow. Now, she had the appointment set up for 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, but she bought a leeway for you, and so you don't need to have it ready until 1 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. Can you do it? Well, this situation comes up all too frequently, and I'm going to show you some nice design and development tricks that will help you through a situation like this. Along the way, you'll get to see a lot on how to do lists. So, geez, over a million names. That's a lot. And if this was the real world and your job was on the line, I can tell you the sweat would pop out on your forehead and your stomach would start to knot up. But all's not lost. Here's what we're going to do. The first thing we're going to do is draw a picture and get a visualization of the data. Now, how are you going to draw a million names? Well, you're not going to. You're going to draw six names or six zip codes. So here's our original array. And we're going to put in, again, this isn't real smart data. This would be smarter data if it was 55430, 5542 or 31, 55432, 55433. Do you see the pattern? But again, I'm going to be doing some sorting and stuff, so I kind of put this out of order so we can see what happens when we sort it. Again, it sounds outrageous having a million names. In today's world, it's not. But always bring your project down where it's manageable. So bring it down. Here we have six elements. Well, we can handle this, right? So here we set up a public class demo. We set up our main. And the very first thing we did is we set up our strings. Now, what's another data type we could have used besides long? Would int go up to numbers that high?
Oh, no. Int only goes up to 127.
Yeah. Int only goes up to 127. What'd you say, Chad?
Double.
We could use double, but then we'd have decimals, and we don't need decimals here. What's another type that we could use that would probably make better sense, especially if we lived in Canada?
String.
Yeah, absolutely. When you work with zip codes, think of them as strings. Postal codes around the world almost always have letters in them. I think the United States is one of the few countries that doesn't. So if we were in Canada, we'd have to deal with alphanumeric. So string is would be a much better choice here, because longs are for doing math on. And you never do math on a zip code. It's usually an identifier. So a string would be a good thing to use. And then I called my little print array routine that we figured out a couple weeks ago. And you can see in here, did I pass in what is inside a zip array? What did I pass in? Yep, excellent. A memory location pointing to this array. And what type is this array? It's an array of
longs.
It's an array of longs. And you can see down here on the signature line, public static void print array, here's my declaration. So zip array is going to become my array inside the method. And this is basically going to walk through and print out my array.
Does it actually print the array out so you can see what's in it, or is it just sending it to memory?
No, it actually prints it out. Let's take a look at it. Yeah. So when you print it out, it's going to say system out println element 0 is, and then it's going to be array 0 is what number? 55431. And then it's going to loop around. X is going to be 1. And my array index 1 is going to be 55420. So yeah, it'll print it out. Now, this is the first smart thing we did was taking our million zip codes and put them down to 6. The second thing is it's smarter to work in the middle of your sample data, so you make sure you get in the middle of your loops. Now, when you do the demo, we'll probably use a J option pane show input dialog box so the vice presidents can type in specific zip codes. But for now, we're just going to hard code the data. You know, why fiddle with extra code you don't need while you're testing things out? So this later on is going to turn into an input statement, but for now, we're just going to hard code 56003. And you can see how I picked data that was right in the middle of my loop. So I'm going to search through my code. So I'm going to look for find zip. I'm going to pass in my array and my zip search. So we're going to have to see what that zip search is. It's probably what? Oh, zip search is 56003. So this is my array. This is the zip code I'm looking for. Now, notice this next line, system out println, and what's happening? If this statement is true, if it comes back with a minus 1, which means we didn't find it, so if this is true, then this, the zip code and the phrase not found, gets printed out. What happens if this is false? Well, yeah, this is going to tell us either that it's not found. What if this statement comes out false? What if it comes out with an index of 3? Now this is a ternary, so what's going to happen? This is the true false. This is the true side. What the heck is this? False. This is the false side. So if this is false, if we come back with something, then it's going to say 56003 found at index, and it's going to give me my result. Do you see here my result was stored? All right, so let's do our search method. So here's our find zip. We're passing in an array of longs, and we're passing in a long zip code. I start out by saying minus 1. Oh, notice my comments return minus 1 if not found. Returns the index number if it is found. So that's what's going to work with my ternary. So I start out assuming we're not going to find it. We say found is not minus, is minus 1. And then I walk through the array, and I say, if it's found, if there's a match here, notice the equal equal. Now, if we were doing this in strings instead of longs, what would I use? Dot equals. I would say z index x dot equals z search. So, but this is a long, so we can say equals equals. If there's a match, we say found. Otherwise, we say minus 1, and we return found. Also, this is following best practices of having only one return statement, not having two or three or more throughout your code. So save things in a variable and then return that variable. So I say go ahead and run it, and it says it didn't find it, right? So you found it, right? How'd you find it? Oh, just looking at it. Okay, usually when you step out. Well, yeah, it's not working. You say, oh, geez, I have a million names. I got to have it tomorrow. Oh, and then the sweat really pops on your head because things are starting to break. But Kyle has it absolutely right. But here's how we're going to debug this. We're going to put it, now you could put a, in Eclipse, you can put a breakpoint in here and you could watch what happens. But right here, I'm saying a debug statement. I'm printing out my array, and then I'm printing out my search. So I'm making sure my incoming data here is correct. And here's what it looks like. Here's my elements. So I know it's in there. And here's my debug statements. So, does this match? No. Does this match? No. But does 56003 match? Well, then what happens? And Kyle already gave away the medicine. But watch how I do this. Now, again, you could put a breakpoint right here and run the program until you got to this statement. But what I did is I put a println and I says, I found it. So when I ran the code, you can see that I found it. And here's the solution that Kyle came up with already. If you need, after you find it, you need to quit looping and tell the program to break. What is right here at this break statement, what will X be? Not, it'll be what? What did you say?
Oh, I don't know. No, I don't know.
Oh, you don't know?
The found will be X, but.
Yeah, what it'll be whatever, whenever the match was, it'll be the index of the match. Everybody see that? Kyle already had this figured out. What it was doing is it was going down here and it was going through all the others, not having a match, and is overriding it. So don't forget those break statements in your loop. So now we're going to try some test data that's not in there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and see if it works. And it should come up, not found. And then just to make sure, I would try something like 55420 and make sure that it came up found. Now, when that image of a million names and the deadline is looming over your head, don't let it cloud your judgment. Stay focused on the problem.